Good afternoon. Welcome to Exploring Religion, What is Mysticism? An afternoon with Dr. Bernard McGinn. We have Kai and myself, Lale, from Calgary Public Library. We are the hosts, and our panelists are Dr. Bernard McGinn and Dr. Carolyn Music. I would like to take a minute to do housekeeping. We are scheduled from 2 to 3 p.m. Dr. McGinn will take pauses for questions. You can ask your questions through Q&A box at the bottom of the screen. Your questions will directly go to our panelists. We will now begin with Lent acknowledgement.
Growing up, my grandma always told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us, and it never asks for anything back.
Everything is connected, and it's not humans and animals or humans and the nature around us. You know, we're all connected.
And that acknowledgement is a way to acknowledge that we're coexisting in this land with the native people, and we should acknowledge that this is actually their traditional territory. But at the same time, we are all guests to this land.
The land plays a big factor in who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
Okay, our moderator is Dr. Carolyn Music. Since July 1st, 2020, Carolyn Music holds the Chair of Christian Thought in the Department of Classics and Religion at the University of Calgary. Dr. Music is currently working on a project that investigates female preachers and their sermons in late medieval and early modern Europe. The holder of the Chair of Christian Thought engages in knowledge translation and initiates and organizes community events. The Swanson Lecture in Spirituality is one of four annual endowed public lectures that the Chair of Christian Thought organizes. The three others are the Lebel Lecture in Christian Ethics, the Bantal Lecture on Education and Theology, and the Iwasa Lecture on Urban Theology. These lectures demonstrate the breadth and depth of Christian culture and reflect how numerous disciplines intersect with the study of religion. The Department of Classics and Religion and the Calgary Public Library have teamed up in partnership with the aim of making the endowed Chair of Christian Thought public lectures accessible to a wide audience across not only Calgary, but the whole Alberta. Dr. Music?
Thank you. Thank you, Lale. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Bernard McGinn, who will be giving this year's Chair of Christian Thought Swanson Lecture in Christian Spirituality. Before I introduce Professor McGinn, I would like to say a few words about the Swanson Lecture. It is an endowed lecture in memory of the Venerable Archdeacon Cecil Swanson, who was born in London, England in 1889. As a young man, Cecil Swanson moved to Toronto to attend Wycliffe College for theological studies and graduated in 1912. In 1920, he became a member of General Synod, the Parliament of the Anglican Church of Canada. He was chairman of the House of Clergy and Laity from 1953 to 1960. When he was 70, he retired to Calgary, where he was until the time of his death in 1984, honorary associate priest at Christ Church Elbow Park. Cecil Swanson was an early ecumenist and lost no chance to bring different denominations of the Christian Church together. He was widely admired for his tolerance and understanding between people of different walks of life and religious belief. We are honored that we can commemorate his memory through the annual Swanson Lecture on Christian Spirituality, which will be given by Professor Bernard McGinn. I'd like to introduce Professor McGinn now. Professor McGinn is Naomi Shenstone Donnelly Professor Emeritus of Historical Theology and of the History of Christianity in the Divinity School at the University of Chicago. Professor McGinn is the author and or editor of over 36 books and well over 300 articles. He is the world authority on the Christian mystical tradition, and his books such as The Foundations of Mysticism, The Harvest of Mysticism in Medieval Germany, and Mysticism in the Golden Age of Spain have shaped the field for generations to come. In addition to being a scholar of the highest distinction, Professor McGinn is an outstanding teacher. He has supervised nearly 70 PhD students, and his dedication to teaching is an inspiration. Even before lockdown and now since March, he has taught a number of riveting webinars on Christian history and spirituality. Today, we are lucky to have the world authority on Christian mysticism examine the question, what is mysticism? The Calgary Public Library, in partnership with the Department of Classics and Religion, University of Calgary, welcomes you, Professor McGinn, to give the 2020 Swanson Lecture in Christian Spirituality.
Well, thank you very much, Carolyn, and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I just want to say a word too about how much I appreciate the tribute to the land and the original peoples. We don't do that in the U.S. very much, as far as I know. I first ran into it in Australia when I lectured on Teresa of Avila in 2015 in several places in Australia for a 500th anniversary. And there, in all three places where I lectured, they have the same memorial or notice, if you will, at the beginning of every event. I really thought it was wonderful, so I'm happy to see it being done in Canada. Let me start with suggesting a kind of thought experiment. When you hear the word mysticism, what do you think of? When you hear the word mysticism, what kind of pops into your mind? I start with that because in the general public, at least, I think mysticism is a very misunderstood word. And most people, or many people, I don't want to say everyone, but for many people, it means it calls to mind something bizarre, uncanny, weird or magical, certainly something irrational. And there's a long tradition, many century tradition, of thinking of mysticism in that way. And much of it goes back to the Enlightenment, and the Enlightenment idea of everything being bounded by reason and having to obey the strict controls of reason. So that if mysticism is not totally rational, well, it has to be something irrational. And I have a nice quotation here, one which I love from a major Enlightenment figure in England. This is Henry St. John Bolingbroke, whose dates are 1678 to 1751. One of his works, Letters and Essays Addressed to Alexander Pope, he says as follows: "All the ways of acquiring a more distinct knowledge of God by archetypal ideas, which we discern in an intimate union of the human with the divine mind, by the irradiations of mystic theology, by the inward light of Quakerism, and several more, which the frenzy of metaphysics, not very distant from that of enthusiasm, has invented, are too ridiculous to deserve the regard of common sense." So for Bolingbroke and others, mysticism is kind of the epitome of the irrational, and as far from common sense as one can possibly get. And it's possible to think that mysticism is not fully rational, religion within reason, within the limits of reason alone. But perhaps rather than thinking in a binary fashion of the rational versus the irrational, the mystic suggests to us that there's actually a ternary. There's three categories. There's the irrational, there's the rational, and the mystics would insist that the knowledge that they teach is suprarational. It's not governed by the ordinary rules of human reason, but that doesn't mean it's necessarily irrational. So even those who don't think that mysticism is necessarily irrational might think of it, and many religious people do, as the realm of paranormal religious experiences, strange stuff, visions, stigmata or bearing the marks of Jesus, levitation, severe kinds of asceticism, other really strange things like the you know, the ability to go for a long period of time without eating. In other words, it's the fringe of religion, the odd fringe of religion. Third category of people would be those who say that, yes, indeed, many great figures can be described as mystics or contemplatives. And sometimes they have these very strange paranormal experiences, but oftentimes they don't, or that's not the heart of it. But they think of mystics as elite people. It's an elite phenomenon. It's something that's meant only for the very privileged few, and therefore it has nothing to do with ordinary Christian living. It's not part of what ordinary Christian life should involve in. Yes, there are great mystics like Teresa of Avila or Julian of Norwich or Meister Eckhart or Bernard of Clairvaux, etc. But these are very, very distinct and very, very unusual. Rare birds, rare aves in that sense. And this, I think, is part of the reaction that happened, again, mostly from the 18th century on, where one school of theologians insisted, yes, mysticism exists as part of Christianity, but it's extremely rare. Very rare and only given by some, to very, very few by divine will. Now, what I'm going to try to suggest in this talk is that all of those ideas and understandings of mysticism are incorrect. And that mysticism, rather, or the mystical element in religion, as I like to put it, or contemplation, which I use as another word for mysticism, these are not irrational. They're not just the realm of the paranormal. They're not just for the very elite. These are something that these are elements that are integral and necessary for Christian living. And indeed, according to the best mystics from the whole history of the last 2,000 years, this mystical element is a part of the vocation that's given to all believing Christians who are from their baptism on. It's part of the grace and the Christian life that they're supposed to live out during their times. And I think the same can be true in other mystical traditions, particularly in Judaism. I think this is very much an aspect of certain forms of Jewish mysticism, perhaps not all forms of Jewish mysticism, but I'm going to be talking primarily about Christianity. And to try to demonstrate, partly through history and partly through analysis, of why mysticism is, as I put it, integral and necessary, and why mysticism might even be considered as part of everyday life. A number of recent theologians who've talked about mysticism have used that phrase of everyday mysticism, that it's a part of the believer's life, if properly understood. And there are some very great figures who have suggested this throughout the course of the 20th century. I'd like to just cite three passages from three important thinkers for you to meditate on or to think about. French priest named Henri Bremond, who died in 1934. He wrote an 11-volume literary history of religious thought in France. And it's one of the great works of really the study of mysticism, looking at primarily France from the late 16th century on. He intended to go down to the present, but he didn't finish. He only got to the end of the 17th century. It's primarily historical, great detail, but he also reflected on the nature of mysticism. At the end of the second volume of the 11, he has a kind of appendix in which he talks about the nature of mysticism. And he has a wonderful phrase there, which I'm going to cite for you. Bremond says, "It is not possible to ignore the mystics without disowning the self. It is not possible to ignore the mystics without disowning the self." I think what he means by this is that not everybody may have great mystical gifts that we think of when we think of a Teresa of Avila or John of the Cross or figures like that. But there's something integral to mysticism that's integral to human nature. So if we disregard mysticism totally, if we dismiss it as something irrational, totally peripheral, we're disowning ourselves in the sense that we're not leaving ourselves open to a deep dimension, which perhaps all Christians share in, on different kinds of levels. And I would very much agree with Bremond here that there's a kind of continuum, if you will, of mystical consciousness or mystical experience. And great figures, the great mystics reach a kind of culmination of this, but many other believers share in it in their daily lives and in the progress of their life. So that's Bremont. Another figure is another French figure, Pierre Théo de Chardin, the Jesuit priest, scientist, philosopher, who dies in 1957, who had great problems with the Catholic Church and the Jesuits. They silenced him and prevented him from publishing during his lifetime, etc. But he was extremely interested in mysticism. I think of him as a great mystic, and his most important works as mystical works. But I'm going to cite a passage from a letter, a letter he wrote to his friend, the Abbé Bruel. The Abbé Bruel, an older figure, was one of the great paleontologists of the early 20th century. Teilhard once wrote to him, I think this is in the 1920s, I don't have the exact date. He says, mysticism remains the great science and the great art. The only power capable of synthesizing the riches accumulated by the other forms of human activity. That's quite an extraordinary claim when you think about it. It's the great science and the great art meant to synthesize the riches that we find in the other forms of human activity. The final figure, excuse me, I want to quote is the great German Catholic theologian Karl Rahner, died in 1984, who wrote extensively about mysticism and all the aspects of Christian theology. In one of his essays, Christian Living Formerly and Today, he makes the statement, and this is often quoted, many of you may have heard this before. Karl Rahner says, the Christian of the future will either be a mystic or will not be a Christian at all. The Christian of the future will either be a mystic or will not be a Christian at all. I think many of us who study mysticism today are very much in full agreement with, all three of these passages that I've cited, but especially Karl Rahner, and the growing interest in spirituality in general, particularly mystical spirituality among sincere Christian believers and in other traditions, I think is a testimony to that. So why is mysticism necessary? Why is it integral to the Christian life? Well, I think if we have a very profound understanding of mysticism, it'll give us some sense why this is the case. And here I'll give you a very preliminary notion of mysticism. I'll expand on this later in a kind of more academic detail. But I would say that mysticism is a deeper sense of God's transforming presence in our lives in a very simple way. Mysticism, or the mystical element, is a deeper sense of God's transforming presence in our lives. And that's why for Christians, it's a part of the baptismal vocation. It's given through grace. And it's meant in the course of a lifetime to give you a gradually deeper sense of God as present and present in a transforming way, changes our lives. It's also important, I think, to understand that, I've used this phrase, mystical element. And I do that very consciously in dependence on one of the great books on mysticism of the 20th century, Baron Friedrich von Hügel's The Mystical Element of Religion, first published in two volumes in 1908. But von Hügel argued there, and I think very powerfully, that mysticism is not the whole of religion. It's one of the three integral factors or features of religion that coexists with along with two other elements, which von Hügel called the institutional element. Now, that is all the various offices and aspects of religion that are institutional and very, very important, and with what he called the intellectual element. The mystical element was the third of three. He represented these through the three apostles. Peter represents the institutional element. Paul represents the intellectual element. John the Evangelist and his mystical gospel represent the mystical element. And von Hügel argues that integral and healthy religion needs to try to be true to all three of those elements in an interactive way. And one of the things that happens in the history of religion, and has often happened, is when one or the other of those elements tries to dominate the other two, religion goes off the tracks. And von Hugel was writing this in the early 20th century at a time when he was a Roman Catholic, a time when the Roman Catholic Church was definitely highly institutional, authoritarian, and more and more controlling of both the mystical element and also the intellectual element. And von Hugel's point was to say, things are wrong, things are out of balance in Catholicism of today. And part of the reason for his writing this book was to try to emphasize the need for reestablishing a balance between the mystical element, the institutional element, and the intellectual element as well. So that, to be interested in mysticism and to emphasize its significance is not to say, well, mysticism is the whole of religion, but it's to say that it's a necessary aspect of religion and it needs to coexist in relationship to the other integral aspects. And then a third point, living a mystical life, or if you will, living a contemplative life, it's not just a matter of performing certain kinds of religious acts, to pray in a certain way, perhaps to perform acts of asceticism. These are necessary, but they're only part of the story. That the mystical life or the contemplative life is a transformative lifestyle that should affect everything that we do, and not just a part of it that we carve out and say, oh, well, this is the spiritual side, or this is the contemplative side, or this is the mystical side. A very important voice in underlining this integrative, transformative lifestyle was the great American Cistercian writer, Thomas Merton. And Merton's books, particularly his New Seeds of Contemplation, I think by far his best book in some ways, also emphasizes very, very strongly that the totalizing and integrating nature of mysticism. I'd like to read you just a half a paragraph from the New Seeds of Contemplation. Merton usually spoke about contemplation because that was the ancient monastic way. He used the term mysticism from time to time, but when Merton says contemplation, I think he's talking about what I'm calling primarily the mystical element. This is what he says. Contemplation is the highest expression of man's intellectual and spiritual life. It is that life itself, fully awake, fully active, fully aware that it is alive. It is spiritual wonder. It is spontaneous awe at the sacredness of life and of being. It is gratitude for life, for awareness and for being. It is a vivid realization of the fact that life and being in us proceeds from an invisible, transcendent, and infinitely abundant source. Contemplation is above all awareness of the reality of that source. So what Merton is saying here about the contemplative life or the mystical life is that it's a total life. It's not just some aspect, something that some people practice, but others are not called to. Now, many people think of mysticism as a kind of very deeply individualistic aspect of religion. It's the mystic by him or herself, off in a corner praying and establishing some kind of relationship with God. And yet I think that too is in some ways a misunderstanding. Mysticism, the mystical element, is indeed very personal, but it's not individualistic. It's not selfish. It's not solipsistic. It doesn't separate you from the believing community, because if one finds God in contemplation, we're finding God not just for ourselves, but also for others. And the test of mysticism is increasing in love of God and love of neighbor. And that's the goal of the mystical journey, which is not just private and individual, but which is also, you know, deeply communal. Which is why, and we have to say that the mystical element is a part of the life of the church. It takes place within the ecclesial community through its activities, And you might say it's the deepest level of the ecclesiological existence of the believing Christian. I think you'll also find that message in contemporary writers. I'm thinking of Pope Francis's encyclical, The Joy of the Gospel, Evangelii Gaudium. I don't have passages here to cite for you, but paragraphs 87 and 92, you'll find very much the same kind of message. So living the mystical contemplative life is really rather different, I think, from those misunderstandings that I started with. It's the place where we're looking to find the true self, and the true self, which is a relational self to other Christians. I'd like to cite just one or two more passages. Somebody said, well, that sounds like a very new message. You know, I thought that mystics were supposed to be these very special people, but you're saying it somehow has a universal aspect to it. Yet if we read through the tradition, which I've done for decades and decades now, we will find that all the great teachers had the same message. And I'll cite just one or two here. Gregory the Great, beginning of the 7th century, in his homilies on Ezekiel, says the following: the gift of contemplation is not given just to the highest — by the highest he means the clergy — and not just to the least people, but frequently to the highest, frequently to the least, frequently to those set apart, the remoti — that means the monks, and sometimes the married receive it as well. Therefore, he says, there is no Christian state from which the grace of contemplation can be excluded. Anyone who has an interior heart can be illuminated by the light of contemplation. So Gregory says, yes, everybody, every member of the Christian estate here — and he, you know, these are the standard categories that he's speaking about — they have the openness to the life of contemplation as long as they have an interior heart. Bernard of Clairvaux says the same in the 83rd of his sermons on the Song of Songs. It's a long passage, so I won't cite the whole thing, but he says that every soul, even the ones who are burdened by sin — and then he has a long series of things about burdened by sin and snared by vices, all the bad stuff that can happen — but he says, even though a soul is damned and filled with despair in this fashion, nevertheless, we have been taught that such a soul can find in itself not only a source for the expectation of pardon, so that it may seek after hope, but even something by which it may dare to aspire to be married to the Word, and not fear to enter into a pact with God, nor shrink from contracting the sweet yoke of love with the King of Angels. So every soul, even the ones who are caught in the worst kinds of sins, have the possibility for redemption and the possibility for entering into a loving marital relationship with the Word, which for Bernard, of course, was the height of contemplation. Thomas Aquinas, in his earliest major writing, not the Summa Theologiae, but his writing on the Sentences, his commentary on Peter Lombard's Sentences, one place he discusses the active and contemplative lives, and he puts it this way very succinctly. Into this fifth point — I mean, he's arguing against an error, I won't read the error — to this fifth point, we answer that not everyone in the active life will come to the perfect state of contemplation. Nonetheless, every Christian who is in a state of salvation must participate in some way in contemplation, since the precept is for all. From the Psalms, it says, be still and see that I am the Lord. So every Christian who is in the state of salvation is called to participate in contemplation, naturally in different levels. But unless you're following that call, you're not following the state of salvation in which you exist. That's what I mean by the kind of continuum of contemplation. And I'll close here with a quotation from the Catechism of the Catholic Church, 1994. This is number 2014. It's Catechism of the Catholic Church, is a pretty long thing, but it's a wonderful citation, and I think it kind of summarizes the long tradition. This is what the Catechism says. Spiritual progress tends toward ever more mature union with Christ. This union is called mystical because it participates in the mystery of Christ through the sacraments, the holy mysteries. And in him, it participates in the mystery of the Holy Trinity. God calls us all to this intimate union with him, even if the special graces or extraordinary signs of this mystical life are granted only to some for the sake of manifesting the gratuitous gift given to all. This is theologically very precise. All are given the gratuitous gift, that is the saving grace. And we're all called to activate that to deeper and deeper appreciation and union with God. But God gives some special graces or extraordinary signs to some folk. These are the great mystics, but only for the sake of manifesting the gift that's given to all, not for themselves, not for their own enjoyment, but for the ecclesial community, manifesting the saving grace that is the essential of the mystical life. It's not the extra graces. It's not the special gifts. It's not the visions. It's not the revelations. It's not the ecstasies, but it's the inner grace by which we get a deeper sense of God's presence and then try to communicate to others. That's the essence of the mystical life. And all the great mystics teach that, even those who are visionaries. I'm thinking Julian Narich, for example, many of you may have read. You know, Julian gets a wonderful special gift, the 16 revelations or showings of the dying Christ that are given to her as she has a kind of near-death experience. And then she reflects on these gifts of the 16 showings. But in one place, I think it's chapter 6, if I recall the short text, she says, well, I've received these gifts, but she said, I know that the gifts don't make me better in themselves. What makes one better is a deeper appreciation of a deeper love of God and love of neighbor. That's what's the essence of what I'm talking about. Teresa of Avila says the same. John of the Cross says the same. Meister Eckhart says the same. Many of these great mystics were actually suspicious of special gifts, very suspicious of ecstasies or ravishments and the like. God could give them for his own reasons, and they knew that from the scriptures, because people in the scriptures had these things, especially of Paul and various others. So that's why I think that the phrase everyday mysticism, as something that we're called to every day and something that we're called to experience in all of our lives, is a crucial and the best way of understanding mysticism. Maybe we'll take a brief break there for questions, because then I want to talk about the nature of mysticism and the different components and aspects to my understanding of mysticism. But we can.
Great, Bernie. Yeah, we do have some questions in. And just a quick note to say, too, that when you originally asked the question about what do people think of when you say the word mysticism, a couple of people wrote in magic, mystery, just to keep you in the loop of what they said. So I'll start with the questions now. So first, why is the institutional expression required for a healthy religious life? What if the institution is unhealthy itself?
That's a very fine question. And I think this is the problem that someone like von Hugo and others were confronting. Von Hugo obviously thought that the Catholic Church, to which he was firmly attached in the early 20th century, was unhealthy. And it was unhealthy because it had lost the balance between the various elements, the institutional element trying to dominate the other elements. But von Hugo didn't leave the Catholic Church. He fought to reestablish the harmony, which is why he wrote that book and numerous other books, and why he became, although he was a layman, why he became one of the best spiritual advisors and counselors of the early 20th century. So it's easy to say things are really bad, and they're bad today in many aspects of many of the churches as well. We can't, you know, pull a rug over those terrible things that have existed in the various institutional communities. We're called upon to work even harder to try to reestablish the proper place for the institution so that it doesn't come, as I said, to dominate or to try to destroy sometimes those other elements that make for healthy religion.
Great, thank you. Next question is, do you think von Hugel's balance exists in today's church?
Not perfectly, certainly. Is it a little better than it was in von Hugel's time? I would say that it is. I mean, I personally am very encouraged by Pope Francis and his sense of the nature of the church as an institution that reaches out rather than creates barriers, both within the church itself to all its different members and also to other religions as well. I mean, this is a constant effort. We're never going to reach in the human world in which we live, the fallen world in which we live, we're never going to reach a perfect kind of balance. But that doesn't mean that we can give up the struggle to try to get the balance as correctly as we can. And why I think the great growth in the interest in spirituality and mysticism over the past 50, 60 years is a sign of so many people trying to reestablish the balance that they felt, you know, had been lost. I mean, we have in the last 50 years produce much more literature and also made available the riches of the mystical and spiritual traditions in a way that never existed before. When you think about it, through large number of publication projects, through various kinds of outreach, through missions, through retreat centers, through programs, through organizations. I am a member of the board of the patrons board for the World Community of Christian Meditators. Some of you may be familiar with that group. They're spread all over the world. These are people who follow the prayer teachings of the English Benedictine John Maine. And I mean, that's just one of numerous groups that are trying to bring the everyday mysticism back into ordinary life.
Great. I think we have, we'll take one more question and then we'll resume there. So this question is, can you comment on whether the growth of Pentecostals at the beginning of the last century in India, US and Canada and around the world were a gift to the church, and if they lost their way in trying to be accepted by the intellectual element?
That's a big question. And to generalize about all Pentecostals would be extremely difficult. I think the Pentecostal movement in itself was certainly a gift of the Spirit. Pentecostalism and the gifts of the Spirit go back to the origins of Christianity. Just read your New Testament, you know, read the Acts of the Apostles, et cetera. But like so many movements, I think there were good elements and there were bad elements. And that's what makes it so hard to give a kind of general general account or make a generalization. So, oh, it's bad, or oh no, it's wonderful and it's good. It was good in some ways, in many ways. It was also perhaps somewhat destructive and misleading in other ways. But I often get asked the question, is Pentecostalism a part of mysticism? And I say, yes, in its essence, I think it is. So that's a short answer to a complicated question.
Thank you.
Shall I go back now to—
Yes, that would be great. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, the second part here, I really want to talk more about the nature of mysticism or my view of mysticism. I want to start with an analysis of the word. Mysticism as a noun is a modern word. Creation of the 17th century. Probably first used in early 17th century France around 1620. La mystique, mystics. Something like mathematics, you could say, comes into English in the 1680s. It seems to me the Quakers are the first, among certain Quakers, who we find the word first in the English language. Many people have said, well, mysticism is a modern word. Maybe we shouldn't use it. This is why I think it's so important to recognize that mysticism is just a more modern version of what the tradition called contemplatio and the contemplative life. But the very notion of the mystical, mysticus, as an adjective or adverb, goes back almost to the origins of Christianity. So it expresses an element that was present in Christianity from at least the second century on. Mystikos from Greek, a generic sense of hidden or secret, originally from a verb that meant to close the mouth in the presence of some kind of secret. And Christians, it doesn't occur in the New Testament, but Christians take over the term mysticus to describe the depth, dimension, the hidden dimension of their beliefs and practices. Clement of Alexandria, whose late second century is one of the first to use that word very extensively, maybe about between 50 and 60 times. And what do they apply it to? Primarily, they apply it to the mystical sense of scripture, the sensus mysticus. Because for all the early fathers, it was not just the surface letter of the scriptures, it was the deep meaning, the hidden meaning, the mystical meaning, which revealed the true essence of Christian belief. So up until the 12th century, mystical generally means relationship to the scriptures, the hidden sense of scripture, because the Bible is always the fundamental nourishment for the mystical life. They also applied the sense of mystical to mystical rites, mystical rituals like baptism and the Eucharist. Because on the surface, a pagan, you know, looking at these rituals, the baptism sees some people pouring water over a little baby, okay, or sees Christians sharing a meal. But the believer sees the sensus mysticus, sees the hidden meaning, that the pouring of water is the freeing from sin and the introduction to a new life in Christ. The bread and wine shared in the Eucharistic meal is a sharing in the very body and blood of Christ. So that's the deep meaning. Mystical also applies to contemplation. Contemplation in general just means, you know, attentive regard or really looking carefully. But contemplatio mystica or theoria mystica means a deep gaze towards the nature of God, towards the supreme reality. And by the fourth century, some writers begin to talk about mystical union, becoming one with God in a hidden way. And by the end of the fourth, early fifth century, we even have the phrase mystical theology, created by the mysterious Dionysius, or pseudo-Dionysius, around the year 500. And mystical theology is not something you go to school to learn. It's not a classroom exercise. Mystical theology is a way of life. It's the Christian way of life as lived within the particular monastic communities that Dionysius lived in and wrote for. So all these qualifiers were, mysticus was attached to a whole range of practices and beliefs and ways of understanding scripture. And so when it moves over to become a noun as the mystical or mysticism, I think it's coming out of that long tradition. As I said, the 17th century is the key phrase here. In the 17th century, we begin to get the term mystics first used about certain Christian believers and leaders before they were called contemplativi, contemplatives. Bernard of Clairvaux in his life was never called a mystic. He was called a contemplative. Dante in Paradiso calls Bernard quel grande contemplativo, that great contemplative. But by the 17th century, early 17th century, they begin talking about certain figures as mystics. This is 20 or 30 years after the lives of Therese and John of the Cross. And in the 1620s and 1630s, their followers are calling them mystics. So there is then, I think, a deep rootedness of our modern term mysticism. And our modern term mysticism was created by religious leaders, but by the 19th century begins to move into a more academic environment. In the late 19th century and the 20th century, it also becomes what we would call a technical term in the study of religion. Now that term mysticus moves into Christianity in the second century with a whole range of other Greek terms that are very closely connected to the mystical element. And let me just mention two or three of these. The first and foremost is the term mysterion, or mysterium in Latin, which you find frequently in the New Testament, particularly in Paul. And it represents the mystery of God hidden throughout the ages, but now revealed in Jesus. Let me just quote Colossians 1:26-27, Paul says, "The mystery hidden through all generations, but now revealed to the saints, the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory." So mysticism, as expressed in that quote I read out from the Catholic Catechism too, the mystical element is rooted in mysterion, the great mystery of Jesus. There are other terms that also come in as they begin speaking about the mystical. One of them is the term contemplation itself, contemplatio, the Greek theoria. That too is not a term you're going to find in the New Testament or even in the Old Testament in its Greek form. It's a term from Greek thought and particularly from Greek philosophy, that is the attentive gaze towards particularly the higher principle, the first principle. You'll find that in Plato, you'll find that in the Neoplatonists, etc. But Christians take it over and they often see it as expressing New Testament texts. The foremost passage here is Matthew 5:8. Blessed are the pure of heart, for they shall see God. They shall contemplate God, is the way in which many of the fathers read that. Another term is deification. Theosis in Greek, deificatio in Latin. Again, this is not a term as such that occurs in the Bible. Although there are certain texts in the scriptures that can be seen as, you know, really saying the same thing without using the term. But it's taken over by Christians as a best way of expressing what's fundamental to Christian belief, especially to belief in the incarnation. The great second century father Irenaeus of Lyon is probably the earliest who puts this very clearly, and it's a great phrase that keeps being cited again and again and again in the history. God became man so that man might become God. That's deification. God became man so that man might become God. And that's why deification, although it's, as I said, not in the Bible, I think is a very legitimate way of thinking about the whole Christian economy. So that's the history. What about the meaning? What about the meaning? In 1899, Dean Ng, in his book Christian Mysticism, said the following: no word in our language, not even socialism, has been employed more loosely than mysticism. And he proceeded to list 26 different definitions that he had found in his reading. Don't forget, this is 1899. In 1978, my friend Louis Dupre, in the article on mysticism in the Iliad Encyclopedia of Religion, says pretty much the same. No definition could be both meaningful and sufficiently comprehensive of mysticism to include all the experiences that at some time or other have been described as mystical. So can we define it? Well, we can't define it in any final way, but we need to talk about it. Just the same way in which we use the term religion, but there are almost as many definitions of religion as there are religionists who talk about defining it. Mysticism, we have a sense of what it encompasses, but there are various definitions, some that bring out one aspect, some that bring out another aspect. What I've given in my works is what I call a kind of heuristic model for understanding the word. I don't call this a hard and fast a definition, but I try to use it as a kind of model that helps us to think about different aspects. And I'm going to read this to you, and then I'm going to talk about seven elements or themes in it. My reader, Essential Writings of Christian Mysticism, has an introduction that talks about that, and then I also use it, of course, in my long history. But here goes. Mysticism is that part or element of Christian belief and practice that concerns the preparation for, the consciousness of, and the effect of what the mystics themselves describe as a direct, immediate, and transformative presence of God. Let me give you that one more time. Mysticism is that part or element of Christian belief and practice that concerns the preparation for, the consciousness of, and the effect of what the mystics themselves have described as a direct or immediate and transformative presence of God in their lives. So let me tease these different elements out and why I've adopted that. Well, first of all, it's a part or element. And I've already said enough about that. And here I was very much influenced by von Hugel, We needed to understand it as a part of the lived religion in which it interacts with others. But the second element is that it's a process. It's what I mean by preparation for, consciousness of, and the effect of what the mystics themselves describe. Many students of mysticism, particularly philosophical students, have seized upon the moment of union with God and the way in which mystics describe that. And for them, that's the essence of mysticism. And so they analyze this account of union and that account of union. I think that's the wrong way to go about it. Mysticism is a part of a life. It's a part of a process. It's a part of a preparation for, and maybe an ongoing preparation for. It certainly involves certain moments or periods of direct consciousness, but it also involves the effect that those periods and that preparation is going to have in your whole life. In other words, it's a part of a life story. It's a process. And if you just study it in terms of, you know, moments of mystical union or mystical consciousness, I think you get the wrong idea. Thirdly, I use the term consciousness. And many people say, well, why use consciousness rather than the more usual term about mystical experience? Well, I can use the term mystical experience, but I think I find consciousness a much more universal term, much more integrative term than experience itself. Mystics themselves talk about experience, and that's perfectly fine. But experience often denotes to people a kind of feeling, a sensation, kind of emotion. And mysticism is more than just a new kind of feeling. It involves the whole human subject. It involves our sensation, our inner and outer feelings, but it involves our thinking, our attempting to understand and to affirm. It also involves our loving, deciding, and active. Now, all of those actions of the human subject, from sensation and feeling through thinking, loving, deciding, acting, they're all conscious acts of the human subject. And they're all involved in mysticism, which is why I think that consciousness is a much broader term than the term mystical experience in itself. When we talk about experience, I'll make one other comment here. The difference between experience of and experience in. We all have experience of things. You know, I have experience of lifting up this little jump drive here, or the experience of pain, or the experience of joy, or experience of sweetness, etc., or the experience of tasting something. Experience of is different from the experience in. Take the example of drinking wine. I taste wine. So I have a taste of wine. But a seasoned wine taster is experienced in wine tasting. He has an inner knowledge about what's good and what's bad about the wine he tastes. So if the mystics are talking about experience, they're really talking about experience in. That is becoming profoundly acquainted with something rather than just experience of. And of course, you know, experience then is an important term, but I want to put it within this wider context, which says that mysticism affects the entire subject and not just, you know, the sense of feeling. The mystics feel something different. No, then they think about it. Then they have an affective relationship to it affectively. And then they have perhaps the decision, you know, they make a choice over that. And in that consciousness, it's rather different perhaps from ordinary consciousness. Most ordinary consciousness, we have an awareness of objects. Then if we reflect, we have an awareness of ourselves. We are the ones who are having the experience. But the mystics insist that there's also a third level of awareness in mystical consciousness. And that's a kind of co-awareness of God, what Thomas Merton once called meta-consciousness. And God's presence within these acts is capable of taking more and more explicit dimensions. You'd say it's always there implicitly, but it becomes more and more explicit to the mystic as the mystic dwells more and more on the presence of God within. And that co-presence then, I would say, has both affective levels and intellective levels or intellectual levels. It has an affective level. It's an awareness of being loved by God in a deeper way. And it has an intellective level. It's understanding God First of all, that God cannot be understood. The mystics have the deepest sense of negation. They know that God cannot really be understood. They have a deeper awareness of that. But they also have often what's called a kind of connatural knowing of God or intuitive knowing of God. Thomas Aquinas writes a good deal about connatural knowing. And you could say that connatural knowing is not knowing more about God. You don't get new truths that you can formulate, but it's knowing God in a new way. It's having a deep, loving affinity with God. So they're both intellectual and affective elements to this kind of consciousness. So the fourth element, because I want to give us a little bit, I call it direct or immediate. Now there's a big issue here. Can God ever be immediately perceived in this life? And this raises theological and philosophical issues that I don't want to go into here. But the mystics themselves talk about God's immediacy. They talk about reaching God in a more direct and immediate way in certain moments of consciousness than in the ordinary life. And that's what I'm pointing to. And I don't want to take up, you know, the delicate issues that are involved in there. The fifth element is transformative, transformation. The effect of mystical consciousness is to change the person and to enable that person to help others to become transformed. Thomas Aquinas coined the famous phrase about, and I quote in Latin, contemplata aliis tradere, to hand on things learned in contemplation to others. And that's what the mystic is called to do. That's why mystics write their works. The truth that they've arrived at, they feel called upon to hand on to others, sometimes through spiritual counseling, sometimes through preaching, but often through writing. And finally, the notion of presence. Why presence, when so many mystics have talked more about God's absence? Well, I think mysticism involves both presence and absence. The great mystics emphasize that. Simon Weil, who I think is a wonderful mystic, if you will, a kind of unchurch mystic, in her notebook says, contact with God is given us through the sense of presence. Contact with human creatures is given us through the sense of presence. Contact with God is given us through the sense of absence. Compared with this absence, presence becomes more absent than absence. So rather than the term mystical union, which I think is only one of the tropes or possibilities to describe God's deeper presence, I think that I like the notion of presence, presence and absence in a kind of intertwined dance, if you will, rather than just seizing on mystical union, which many mystics do, but some mystics don't use union language. There's lots of other kinds of language: vision, contemplation, radical obedience, deification, epectasis, perfection, pure prayer, et cetera, et cetera. But I think that presence encompasses all of these, which mystics then will talk about in different ways in their actual writings. I could say more, particularly about the notion of mystical language, but I want to leave a little time for questions. So I think I'll stop there.
Okay, thank you so much. We have time for two quick questions. The first is, how important is routine discipline in living a mystical life?
Yes, I think it's very important. And this is where the traditional teachings of the great mystics enter in, because it does demand a kind of discipline. It does demand a commitment to a certain regime and certain life of prayer, certain attitude of openness, certain kinds of practices, even, you know, ascetical practices. So sometimes there are great mystics who seem to, you know, go the way without that, but the vast majority of mystics have practiced the kind of religious life which leads them towards an openness, towards the divine grace that is the mystical consciousness.
Okay, and this is a quick one, Professor McGinn. What authors, mystics, texts would you recommend for people new to the tradition?
Yes, well, I often get asked this question, and you know, I mentioned Julian of Norwich before. Julian of Norwich, excuse me, is remarkably accessible in a way that some other mystics are not. And her message is also remarkably deep. So I think one can start with Julian, who's extremely attractive and who writes for her even Christian, for her fellow Christians. And certainly there are other mystics. I mean, Meister Eckhart, another great friend of mine, is a wonderful person. And Meister Eckhart's sermons, difficult as they are greatly attractive to many people whom I meet in my talks and say, oh, I've been reading Eckhart for years. Reading Eckhart is hard. So you sometimes need background. But for some people, he's very attractive. But I think Julian is almost universally attractive in that sense. So I would start, if you haven't read Mystics, I would kind of start with Julian.
Thank you so much, Professor McGinn. Unfortunately, we're out of time. There are more questions, but we must end it there. Thank you for your wonderful talk on what is mysticism. And now we will hand it back to the Calgary Public Library. Thank you.
Sorry about that. Oh, thank you, Dr. McKean. That was a great lecture. Kai, you had some announcements to make. If you could do that, please, and then we'll be ending.
Sure. Thank you all for spending your beautiful Saturday afternoon with us. To conclude today's program, I'd like to draw your attention to two fantastic programs coming up in early December. We have a wonderful holiday cooking program with celebrity chef David Rocco on December 10th and high energy uplifting program on happiness in the age of COVID with New York University instructor Dan Lerner on December 8th. Please do join our next Exploring Religion in the New Year. Do check out our website for more information and registration at calgarylibrary.ca. Have a great day. Thank you all.
Thank you. Yes, goodbye.